Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday Morning, the Old Cookbook Show. Today we're going to do a recipe out of this cookbook, printed in 1880. It's called Buckeye Cookery and Practical Housekeeping. And this was sent in by a viewer, and they also sent this reprint version, which is super fantastic because I can flip through this one and find recipes, and I don't have to manhandle the original all that often. And this is a great cookbook. And even better than a viewer sending this to me, they sent a letter along with it that details how this person's great-great-grandmother wrote this cookbook. So there's a very personal connection to this cookbook, and I feel so honored that they sent it to me, that they've entrusted this book to my care. And there's some great recipes in it. And it's a cookbook that I consider from a very transitional period. There's a couple of transitional periods to me when I look through these old cookbooks. One of them is in the 1600s, just after the European discovery of the New World, where I live, North America, South America, Central America. And all of the foods that were brought from here and taken back to Europe and Asia. Things like tomatoes, potatoes, peppers, hot peppers, that sort of thing. Those didn't exist in the rest of the world. They were directly from here. And that changed cooking. And you see in the 1600s sort of this transition as these new ingredients are incorporated. In the 1880s, you start to see a transition in the way that cookbooks are presented away from being written for people who already had cook's training, who were chefs already or had worked in kitchens their entire lives and were using the cookbooks just as sort of crib notes to get by or as crib notes to exchange ideas. And the recipes weren't fully formed. You had to use your own knowledge to actually make what was in the book. In this time period, cookbooks are shifting to being written for people who have no formal cook's training. And therefore, they include better directions, better ingredient lists, better measurements, the whole nine yards. And so you start to see this transition, and this is a great example of that transition. So today we're going to make a cornstarch cake. So I'm going to start out in this bowl with some butter and some sugar, and we're going to cream those together. Okay, that's looking like it's creamed together pretty well. Yes, I'm cheating. It wouldn't have had these hand mixers in the 1880s. Now, next up, I'm going to deal with the flour. To the flour, I'm going to add cream of tartar and baking soda. And you see that a lot in this time period. Again, sort of transitional. Baking powder wasn't trusted as much as using soda and cream of tartar. Okay, the flour is mixed together. Next up, I'm supposed to mix sweet milk with the cornstarch. So, a little bit of cornstarch in, start stirring it up. Probably a whisk would be much better than a spoon. Maybe I'll switch to a whisk. At this point, I'm just going to start mixing the milk and the cornstarch into the butter and see what happens. So here we go. I'm going to get back in there with my mixer. There we go. Everything's fine. Okay, that came together really well. Now, the next instruction in this book is to then add the whites and the flour gradually until all is used. I would have assumed, based on all of the other recipes that I've ever done, that the egg whites would be whipped to sort of medium or stiff peaks. And I started to whip them together, and then I realized, no, it doesn't say to whip the egg whites and then fold them in. It just says to add them. So I'm assuming then, at this point, that I just add the egg whites into here and then start adding the flour, or maybe alternating between the whites and the flour, because it just says add the whites and flour gradually until all is used. So, let's go. I'm going to put in some of the egg whites. that I've already started whipping together. Not a problem. It'll be okay. They incorporate really quickly. And now some of the flour. And I think I'm just going to alternate back and forth between the flour and the egg whites until all is used. So that mixed together really nicely. I switched to a rubber spatula right at the end. The last ingredient is the flavoring. And the book says to use either lemon or rose water. And I find it very interesting. So this cookbook is 1880. From the Midwestern United States. Only one cake in this recipe book uses vanilla. And remember earlier I said about transitions and that transition between New World ingredients and Old World cooking. Vanilla was a New World ingredient that grew quite easily in Mexico where it was native to, but it didn't always produce fruit. It didn't always produce a bean. And humans could not figure out for the life of them how to get the vanilla flour to create a pod. We didn't understand the process by which it was pollinated. And very early on, we took the plant all over the world to places where it would grow, but still, they couldn't get it to pollinate. It's not until 1841 humans figured out how to pollinate it so that we could consistently grow a vanilla crop. And even then, because of the life cycle of vanilla, it took a lot of years before we started to grow it in any great quantity. So quite reasonably, in 1880, when this book was published, vanilla would still have been fairly scarce to people living in rural Midwestern United States, Ohio particularly. So other flavorings are what you find in these cakes. So there's a lot of brandy flavoring. There's a lot of lemon. There's a lot of rose water. A lot of whiskey. As the flavorings to the cakes, or cakes without flavoring whatsoever. Now, the next problem, of course, is always baking. As much as there's a lot of really good instructions in this book, well, that tastes quite nice. No instructions about baking, no instructions about the pan. I've prepared two pans, a 9x9 and a 9x11. And I think I'm gonna go with the 9x11. The oven is already preheated to 350. So we'll get this in and get it baked. Hey, Jules.
Hey, Glen. Yay, cake.
So we have here a cornstarch cake.
Okay. So no flour, just cornstarch?
No, there is flour.
Okay. I was like, wow, that would...
I brought forks, but maybe we don't need them.
Probably not.
Let's see. It's got a really nice texture.
It's a lovely sponge cake. It's a nice lemony cake.
Yeah, it has a really nice texture. That's a nice cake. I put in maybe 2/3 of a lemon worth of zest.
Okay.
I'd up the zest maybe a little bit to bring a little bit more brightness, but I think this is pretty good anyway.
And you could ice it.
You could ice it. And of course, you know, it's 2021. We do have easy access to vanilla. You could put in vanilla if you wanted to. You could put in the vanilla with the lemon.
It's even a cake you could do in two rounds
and stack it.
Do like a cake, you know.
This is a candles. Winner. I think there's a lot you could do with this cake.
Mine's gone. So
yes. So thank you very much for that book. That is an amazing book. The story that goes with it is amazing. And there's a lot of great recipes in there, so you're going to be seeing this show up over and over and over again on the old cookbook show. Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.